Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to the CEC-UGC live lecture. Dear friends, with our ongoing series on gender studies, today we would be talking on gender and health. And for this great discussion, we have once again with us in our studios Dr. Archana Prasad. Dr. Archana Prasad is an assistant professor in Department of Sociology, Kamala Nehru College, University of Delhi. Dr. Prasad has immense experience, and her experience would definitely help us out in understanding the topic in detail, gender and health. Hello, ma'am. Welcome to the UGC lecture.
Hi, Angitika. Good morning and welcome to the gender series. This is the 13th lecture in the series on gender studies, and we are today going to talk about gender and health. Health is an important concept of life. It is important that we maintain a good health. And health is not only about absence from disease, it is about the overall physical, economic, social and mental well-being of an individual. And therefore, it becomes very significant that how the health or the well-being of both men and women in the society are maintained. Today, with a very fast-growing economy, with too much of disease around, it becomes very significant to understand how gender norms and structure affect our health and well-being. So we try to understand what is health. Health is not only the absence of disease or disability, but encompasses a person's state of complete physical, emotional, mental and social well-being. Being a male or female has profound impact on our health. And the availability of access to health facility. This becomes very significant in our country because of the divide between the rural and the urban, where large population are in the rural areas, and especially women who are illiterate, who don't have economic assets, do not have access to the right medical facility at the right time, leading to a large number of deaths in our country. And therefore, gender inequality exists in access to health promoting resources, which has damaging effect on the well-being of the women. Men face particular problem because of the norms of masculinity. They want to maintain the gender stereotype of being man as being strong, men as not, if you are man, you don't cry. These kinds of stereotypes prevent men from taking access to certain health facilities which should be taken for their well-being. Large number of gender stereotypes prevents men from accessing certain medical facilities on the ground of maintaining their masculinity. So that needs to be looked into from a gender perspective. Our aim is to examine whether and why various aspects of men's and women's health are different. So we don't assume that gender is neutral. It is affected by gender relation. And that is how structures, institutions, cultural expectations modify the patterning of health by sex and gender. Here it is important to understand both sex and gender because it is a question of biology, because a part of our health is related to the way hormones are produced, the way the body metabolism takes place. So the constant distinction between sex and gender has to be maintained. The next is how social environment and this construction of gender influences health behavior. That is use of certain health facilities, use of certain medical treatment, which are again based on gender norms. And the example could be in terms of the contraceptives, which is structured around gender relations. That certain ideas prevent men from using certain contraceptives, and it is considered as the responsibility of women for the control of population. So it is very important also to understand that health is not only restricted to reproductive health of women. Most of the time it is assumed that when we talk about women's health, it is only about her reproductive health, and therefore too much of emphasis is paid on the reproductive health of the women, and mental health, other kinds of medical problems are neglected from analysis of the health policies. So we need to understand the understanding of the health as a holistic kind of understanding, where we look into the well-being of both men and women. Why does gender matter? And that is to understand that gender matters because of the statistics which are in front of us, which is that the most life-taking ailment, which is HIV/AIDS, more than 50% of those living with AIDS are women. In sub-Saharan African countries, it is nearly half the population of both men and women who are suffering from HIV/AIDS problem. Then in our country, in India, we see the whole question of missing women. And that is a large number of feminists have given the concept of disposable daughter, that daughters are disposed of. The sex ratio is skewed, and to the approximately 16 million daughters in our country are missing. So you need to look into where is the error, where a large populations are being just disposed of. The other significant health problem, which is a global phenomena, is a question of mutilation and circumcision. Genital mutilation and circumcision are cultural religious practices which are structured around gender relations. And it is not only trying to structure gender norms around certain reproductive behavior, but it is also to control certain kind of misconceptions about gender and sexual relations. And this the whole issue of genital mutilation and circumcision has led to a large percentage of death among women and men. So we need to understand that health has to be understood from a gender perspective. If we look into gender and health relation, we see it's a life cycle kind of a approach. It is not something at one point of thing. And this is more so specifically to women, where it becomes a problem from womb to tomb, that is from birth till death. In the childhood, we see this whole issue of sex selective abortion, which has become a huge global phenomena, and laws in case of child sex ratio being skewed in our country to the extent of going down to 700 in some of the states in our country. Then in childhood, we also have the problem of circumcision and mutilation, which is has already been discussed. And then the major gender problem in childhood is the question of neglect, where there is a preference for son. Large number of families, they neglect the health of the girl child. The girl child, even if she is 8 years, she becomes the caretaker of her younger sibling. As a result, the resources available in the family is distributed according to norms. So if there is the desire, if there is an insufficiency of, say, certain nutrients in the family, it is the male child which is given first a preference and then the girl. This leads to a kind of a neglect among female population. Then when we move to adolescence, we see that we have a huge population health problem of unwanted pregnancy, which is also responsible for a large percentage of death among young adolescent girls. Then the huge another significant problem of Indian society is sexual abuse and rape, which has become a part of a health problem. It's not only a question of cultural norms, it's not an only question of the women's virginity being questioned, but it makes a major impact on the health of the women. And again, we see that there is a kind of a nutritional neglect, and this is again structured around gender norms, where there is a significance given to men as breadwinner and the first one to have access to nutrition, access to resources which are available in the household. Then in the whole idea of elderly people are having increase in morbidity. There is a decline in the quality of life, and this carries on from the childhood to adolescence. The neglect which has been done in the childhood and the adolescence gets reflected in the elderly women, where there is a decline in the quality of life that the women are going to lead. And then again we have a question of widow norms and behaviors, which has been laid down and which again restricts the nutritious and the well-being of elderly women and widow, and therefore it becomes a problem which is continuous from childhood to older, and then maybe carried on till the end. Another important thing is to look into the paradox between gender and health. And when we talk about the gender and health paradox, it implies that there is a certain kind of inconsistency between certain kind of facts which is between men and women. And there is a clear inversive pattern in the comparing gender differences in mortality and morbidity. Women have higher morbidity, that is sickness, but they live longer than men, that is they have a lower mortality rate. And the idea is that even though they have a lower mortality rate, the death of the women or the number of women which is in the country is less because of the neglect, and that is which is very significant to understand, that there is a neglect and there is a denial of access to certain health facility which leads to larger percentage of women becoming victim to certain kind of diseases. Men have low morbidity, that is sickness, chronic condition rates, but do not live as long as women. That is, the mortality rate among men are low. The paradox of men's high mortality and low morbidity compared with women can be explained by gender differences in age-related patterns of disease. Men have more life-threatening chronic diseases at young age, including coronary heart disease, cancer, cerebrovascular disease, cirrhosis of liver, kidney disease and atherosclerosis. In contrast, women faces high rate of chronic disorders such as autoimmune diseases and certain disorders which are life-threatening. Disease such as anemia, thyroid conditions have become a common disease among all women, gallbladder conditions, migraine, arthritis and ischemia. These are facts which are based on studies on women and health. Overall mental health is similar among both men and women, but specific conditions differ by gender. Women experience substantially higher rates of depression and anxiety disorder than men. And this again has been explained by feminists in terms of the social structure or the social condition in which women are living, which is leading to a certain kind of increase in depression and mental illness among women. Men have higher rates of substance abuse, antisocial behavior and suicide. So, how do we explain the gender difference in health? We have seen in the previous understanding that there is a certain kind of difference between women and men in terms of certain kind of diseases affecting them, in terms of mortality, in terms of morbidity. So there are certain explanations which have been given by theorists to understand the difference in health. And number one is the difference in terms of artifact explanation. There are theorists who believe that it is an artifact, that is, it is an artificial kind of a condition. Women are not actually suffering from these diseases, but they try to make it more conscious or make it more known to people because they become more, they are more, take their notices more seriously, they recognize the symptoms and they take access to it. But such theories does not hold valid because many a time we see that it is on the contrary that women are supposed to take on pain. They are not supposed to complain about it. They are not supposed to make a issue out of it. So it's a part of their socialization, gender socialization, where a large women continue to survive with pain and disease in there rather than going out and taking medical help. The second explanation is genetic or biological, and the biological explanation is in terms of the difference in chromosomes and hormones, and the health differences are explained in terms of the difference in the male and female hormones. And this explains the difference between men and women. Statistics that are often used to show female superiority, that is the lower rate of mortality, refer to difference in male and female conception, fetal mortality, stillbirths and infant mortality rates. So in a very commonsensical understanding, it is said that women are the genetic makeup of women is that they can survive, they can take on diseases more, and that is because of the biological makeup that makes them more biologically stronger than men. It is also argued that females, due to their biological and genetic constitution, reproductive anatomy and physiology, may be endowed with resistance to certain diseases. So, this is a theory which is coming in from those who support biology as significant for understanding the gender difference. And there are studies which show that it is because of this difference in hormone and in the chromosome that women are able to resist certain kind of disease, and therefore the mortality rate is lower among women. But more than the artifact explanation and the biological explanation, what is more significant to understand gender relation is to understand the social factor which is responsible for the gender difference. And this is where the gender becomes very significant. That it the biological difference will be negligible when we look into the extent to which social structures, institutions, cultural practices, norms are structured in such a manner that women's health becomes problematic. So, the social factors talks about the social and economic inequality. So, there will be a vast difference between the access to health facility between rural women and an urban women, between upper class women and a lower class women. And that is to say that health intersects between gender, caste, class, community and religion. Social and economic differences produce differential opportunities and life chances. Social role and relative activity expose men and women to different health risks. So, it's also in kind of a gender relations where we look into occupational risk. So, the structures of society is such that women were prevented from certain areas in occupation because it was considered as a health risk factor. So, men were more prone to these risks and prevented women from them. It is also argued that male socialization and lifestyle exposes them to riskier, aggressive and dangerous behavior. So, in the beginning I just said that it is the whole idea of maintaining a certain kind of masculinity which is considered as normal, and the masculinity which has been defined as normal is aggressive, which is something which is defined as strong. So, it prevents or rather makes men get involved in certain kind of risk related behavior or dangerous behavior just to expose of your masculinity. So, this then again is related to the health of men. For example, men have a higher rate of accident because of the higher mortality because of the motor vehicle accident. And this is not only many a time, it is also a stunt source where we try to expose our masculinity, which end up in taking the life of the person. Men are more likely to indulge in excessive smoking, drinking, substance abuse with negative health consequences. So, this is again a gender related which to a large extent is in our everyday life, where if we look into a man smoking, it is considered as normal. But if we see a girl or a woman smoking, then we make a issue out of it and we consider that smoking behavior as unfeminine, or it is considered the character of the women is accordingly judged. So, this is not only limited to gender inequality, but it has a negative consequence on the health of men. It is pointed out that the over demanding and contradictory social roles of women produce negative health outcomes. So, this is also in terms of the structuring of the marriage and family institutions, where it is responsible for the women to take on the responsibility of the groom, and it has been argued by a large number of feminists that this transfer of a woman from her parental home to her marital home has a large amount of impact on the mental health of a woman, and many a time a large number of young girls are unable to cope up with this transition and has a negative consequence on the health. Domestic work responsibility increases with a certain age, it increases with your marital status, and this again the whole burden of care and taking care of the entire family is on the family, especially the daughter-in-law, and this increases the physical labor that women has to do, and it many a time leads to a neglect of certain amount of health factors. So in a way, it then can be said that women are then taking on the burden of disease of the, and therefore you need to understand why gender norms and relations are structured in a manner that they, it leads to a kind of a gender difference between men and women. So women are exposed to higher risk and vulnerability, especially women who are in the rural areas, women who don't have access to facilities. At the household level, investment in the nutrition and care and education is significantly different between men and women. Access to health services are affected by gender norms. Experience in healthcare setting is different. And it's not just a question of biology, but it's also more important in terms to understand social cultural relations which are leading to the difference between men and women. Low social autonomy of women exaggerates their biological vulnerability to infections such as HIV and malaria. So it is because of the social environment to which women are exposed that the higher percentage of HIV AIDS found among women is responsible for the cultural environment in which they are brought up. And it is also important to understand how there is inequality in terms of access to healthcare services. There are certain barriers which prevent women from accessing certain healthcare. They have problems in accessing treatment in some countries. There is barriers to equitable care, includes difficulty in taking time off work, caring responsibility, and lack of income. Here, it is also important to understand the whole idea of taking the double burden of public work and the domestic work. In the between the taking the double dual responsibility, large number of time women are unable to take out time, are unable to take out a significant amount of time to have health care services of their own body, and therefore it has been suggested that after a certain age it is required that you have a monitor your health problems on a regular basis. Analyzing the quality of healthcare is difficult because healthcare is again different. It is not a kind of a uniform pattern for the entire population. So you, how you access healthcare, what kind of facilities is available to you, how much of income is available for accessing those facilities becomes significant in terms of determining and the care that can be available to men and women. Along with the inequalities in healthcare, we also have access to healthcare, which is a certain kind of based on certain inequality. And here we see four sets of related conditions which matter in terms of access to healthcare, and that is need, permission, ability, and availability. Need implies that is it there a need to report a certain kind of illness, or is there a need for a certain kind of physical ailment in the body to be subject to medical care. And gender norms are such that most of the time the need of women are considered as subordinate to the need of men, and men would be given more access to certain medical facility, whereas it would be denied to women. When we look to ability to access, again the mobility of women or the way in which women are socialized limits them to be able to access certain facility on their own. So poor women cannot afford to wait for long periods at government facility and to get available. Many a time and many poor women do not have the ability to go to the clinic which is at a distance, and therefore the health gets affected. Availability is again whether it is available at a close accessible distance or it is not available. So when we look into the health and well-being of women in India, we see a large number of health related problems that women in India are facing. Nutritional deprivation has been complained, the whole deficiency related problem of calcium, iron, magnesium, n number of deficiency has been found among large men and women, larger women than men. There is a differential treating of girls in terms of feeding practices, utilization of household resources, access to health care, and therefore there is a high female morbidity and mortality in India among the younger population. Malnutrition is a major consequence of anemia. Anemia, iron deficiency has been found. 90% of all pregnant women in India suffer from anemia. And this is according to the World Bank report of 1996. Some of the common problem which is found among all women, which can be termed as universal health problem, are osteoporosis, osteoarthritis, backache. These are all because of nutritional deficiency in women, which can be traced back to the neglect from the birth till old age. And that is because gender norms are structured in such a way that the health of the women are considered as subordinate to the health need of men. The more important in Indian context is in terms of the violence which women in India, whether it be physical violence, sexual abuse, has led to a negative consequence on women. Every day we hear from reports of large number of young girls and women being subject to certain kind of violence, and these violence are having a negative impact on the health of the women. And with this, we come to an end to part one of the lecture. Welcome to the second part of this lecture on gender and health. And in the second part, we'll be looking into the whole question of population control and family welfare. Because the way in which population control and family welfare policies has been framed and implemented in India, it has a wider gender implication. Because it is in terms of these policies which are being framed by the government that we look into the statistics which has come in, and that is if we look into the population of the country, according to 2011, India's population stood at 1.21 billion, comprising 623 males and 586 million females. So we see the difference between male and female population. So it is also that we see it is India which has the highest rate of female sterilization, because the whole burden of the population and family welfare is on the on women. So we'll look into how family welfare population policy and family welfare policies has been a certain kind of gender imbalanced, where the focus is to control birth rate rather than to look into the holistic well-being of the population. So it the only objective is to arrive at certain numbers, at certain figures, whereas the qualitative aspect has been neglected. And this also raises certain questions on the policies which has been there to control illegal sex selection and sex selective abortion, because we see the child sex ratio has declined from 927 in 91-2001 to 914. And what is more significant is to see that certain kind of assumptions or certain signs of understanding which were among people have changed, because many of the states which had a more balanced sex ratio are showing a decline, and therefore the whole idea that it is only a problem among the rural people or it's people with a low economic background that are subject to sex selective is becoming problematic, because it is being reported from states or districts which are considered as more economically uplift. It's also being reported from many rural areas as well as urban areas. So it has become a real social issue in today's society. The population policy, we see that it was 1952, when the government of India was first in the world to launch a national family planning program, which later on expanded to include maternal health. Maternal health implies health of the women during pregnancy, childbirth and postpartum period. Because in the early 80s, 90s, there was a high rate of mortality, maternal mortality rate in India. And that could was being reported because of the way in which deliveries or pregnancies were handled, where it was relied on traditional method. So the government of India brought about policies which focused on public health facilities and ensured that the majority of the women have access to these health facilities in order to control the maternal mortality rate in India. And then it was also the policy which came in to control sex selective abortion was in terms of the medical termination of pregnancy. Now, the medical termination of pregnancy is again a dual sword kind of a thing, because on one side, it controls misuse of technology for sex selective abortion. It prevents pregnant women from undergoing abortion on certain grounds. But then the debates which comes in from the Western countries or from countries, developed country, is that pregnancy reproduction is a part of women's own choice. So the whole idea is to give women the freedom to take decision, that it is her decision whether she wants to abort or not. But in country like India, where there are large number of social cultural norms which regulate the choice of a woman, it is significant to have a policy which regulates a certain kind of abortion, and therefore it is under only medical conditions that such terminations can take place. So why do we need family planning in the first go? Because it is considered as one of the important goal for sustainable development. Because if the population is going to increase at a rate at which it was at one point of time, it is going to affect the entire population. So in order to combat poverty, in order to have a holistic development, it is required that there is a family planning norm. Family planning also ensures safe and reproductive women health, because then again the entire maternal health is under the government's regulation. Family planning is about women's right, because it has one point of time the whole understanding of women's restriction to domestic sphere as reproductive vehicle had to be brought into control, where it is seen that it is only a part of women's life, it's not everything about women life, and therefore family planning is central to gender equality and women's empowerment. There are certain benefits of family planning because the government of India is investing amount in family planning. It enables families, women and couple, to decide on the number of the children and spacing of the children. Again, the number and the spacing of the children is not only beneficial for the couple, that is husband and wife, but also for the health of the newborn. Prevents unintended pregnancies. So there is a large number in a country which is also ruled by religious norms, where it is considered as gift of God, it is important to regulate the number of child born or limit unintended pregnancies. It promotes equality between men and women and raises women's status in society. It provides cost-saving benefits to women who could not have access to all the health resources. That is specifically for women in the rural area, women in the backward areas where they are illiterate, where they are not economically sufficient, it is the family planning or the family welfare policy which comes to their rescue. It fosters social economic development, therefore it is key to reducing poverty and overall economic development of the country. When we look into family planning, it has certain kind of benefits for women per se. That is, if women are subject to accepting the family planning norm, it is implying the use of modern contraceptives. It has certain benefits for women. That is, they can decide the number of children that they want, the spacing of the timing of the children. And this is again the large amount of international agreements which has come in, enables women and girls to spend more time on education, training and employment. So it is a choice of the women to decide which is more significant, which is the reproductive aspect, or it is more time given to in terms of education, training and employment. Has been shown to increase the likelihood that women will be involved in education and the labor force. So the whole idea of the domesticity of women is being considered as being more flexible, because you have the system where you can avail certain norms, certain policies to regulate the way in which women's life was only dedicated to domesticity. Ultimately enables women to better support their families, contribute to the communities and be involved in political life of their countries. And that is why I said that it leads to certain kinds of women empowerment in a way. But the way in which gender family planning programs have been framed and implemented, we see a certain kind of gender imbalance in the planning policies. Because the key component is on sexual and reproductive health. So the other aspects of health has been neglected. So they only take care of the reproductive health of the mother and the child, maternal health of the child. But mental, physical and other kind of illness are not taken care of. So gender differences is starkly seen in family planning programs of India. They are the policies in a way favors men and sexual and reproductive health decision, because again in a situation where patriarchy dominates, these decisions of the availability of contraceptives or the use of certain family method planning is in the hands of the men, and most of the time it is again the gender notions of masculinity and femininity which plays a dominant role in deciding the use of these methods for family control. The number of women with unmet need for contraceptive method is higher in India than elsewhere in the world. Male gender norms are generally accepted as factors influencing a range of family planning and reproductive health behavior. This includes the use of family planning method, the use of these methods for prevention of diseases and to prevent women violence against women. Again, the male sterilization is viewed as culturally unacceptable in India because it questions the masculinity of men, and therefore female sterilization rate in India is higher than in any part of the world. So going back to the whole idea that it is the responsibility of the women to control the population, or they become the burden of family planning and population control is on women. India's method is skewed towards female sterilization, and range of methods women can use to space their birth is narrow. The three national family health surveys show that female sterilization is on rise and male sterilization is constantly on low. So the limitations of the family programs are that it has a negative impact on the health of the women. A large number of poor women are forced to undergo sterilization, and it has been reported in the last month that a high percentage of death occurred because of these sterilizations, which takes place in private hospital at a certain economic to meet the need of the women. The poor women just are lured with certain economic benefits to undergo sterilization, which has a negative impact on the health of the women. Contraceptive used on women for testing. So this is again a part of the women's campaign in India where in the early 90s, these Indian women who were the poor, illiterate women, just for the, with giving them certain amount of women, were used as guinea pigs for testing contraceptive methods which had high negative consequences on the body. So the women movement or the women campaign against the use of body for testing these medicines was raised, and it was successful in bringing an end to this. Then a large number of contraceptives are sold over the counter without any medical help, and these are easily accessible to young girls, which is again a point of health because it is not taken under medical supervision. So the whole idea is that the population control is gendered in the sense that it is focusing on birth control, and secondly, it is taking women as the target of, or it is a women's sole responsibility of controlling the population. So there is a need for integrating gender into the family planning programs. Men and women need to have access to equal decisions making power in all family decisions, because it's a question of a family decision, so it should not be a bias towards one gender. The health of the family depends on this equality. Men and women need to open with one another about the family planning decisions and agree after getting all information from the clinic or medical supervision. So this is not to be taken on individual basis, because again it will have negative health impact. Integration of gender into the family planning program will improve the health of not only women but the men and the younger generation as well. There is a kind of a general shift in the population because of the campaign and the women's movement, where the focus was on birth control to the reproductive health of the women. And there are policies which takes into control the reproductive health of women in India. So there is a movement from birth control to reproductive health, and there is a reproductive and child health program is an important component of NRHM and aims at reduction of infant mortality rate, maternal mortality ratio and total fertility rate, because at one point these are all part of the development goals in at an international level. So the Janani Suraksha Yojana was launched by the government. It's a 100% centrally sponsored scheme, and it integrates cash assistance with delivery and post-delivery care. The objective of it was to ensure that the maternal mortality rate especially in the rural areas would come down. It was launched with a focus on demand and promotion of institutional delivery, because it was assumed that the traditional method of delivery was one of the major factor for the increased high maternal mortality rate among women. It targeted at lower MMR rate, that is maternal mortality rate, by ensuring delivery by skilled birth attendants. So these ashas were given special training to impart delivery in a safe and in a healthy manner. The Yojana identified ASHA as an effective link between government and the poor pregnant women in 18 low-performing states. In other states and UTs, there were Anganwari workers, the other agencies of the government which are taking part in the schemes and policies to ensure that the maternal health of the women is save and it is taken care of. The scheme has shown phenomenal growth in the last 3 years, and it is it has been successful in reducing the MMR rates in the country. So even though there was certain lacunae or there were certain limitations, it has been able to achieve certain positive outcome for women, and therefore it is very it is the most significant part in terms of understanding the positive outcome of the population policy, is that it leads to freeing women, or that is that it reproduction is not becomes voluntary, that it is not necessarily to be indulging in reproductive action, and you have to look into reproduction only as an involuntary act, and it should not hinder the question of education and the work or the labor participation of female population. So the reproductive revolution, that is the shift from sixth birth, that is we are familiar that in our country there was a time when women would have 6 to 9 to 11 children. The whole family population norm of limiting it to say 2 child and 1 child has brought about a significant improvement in the maternal health of women. And that is also important to see how the family planning norm is able to question the domestic and public dichotomy, which was a significant part of the social structuring of gender relations. That it is because that women were involved in reproductive act and reproductive reproduction, where they were having children after children, which was preventing them from taking part in the public life, has now become more flexible. Whereas it's only a certain period of the fertility period or the adolescent age where women are supposed to be into the family planning, and then they can take part in the labor participation. So it is an important step as a fundamental human right in terms of choosing the number of children and the time, which is very significant. In many Western countries, they are the right of women to actually even abort if they are not medically, mentally ready for the child. So if we look into the kind of the discussions which has been taken place, we look into the summary of the lecture, we see that many a time, even when disease are said by both the sexes, that is, there are certain areas where there is no gender difference in terms of certain illness or certain disease, but then the difference will be in terms of manifestation or natural histories in women and men. That is how the society has responded to these differences or disease. And also in terms in the difference in severity of the consequences. So many a time person may be suffering from certain kind of disease or ailment, which if is considered in terms of the gender norms, is considered as the breadwinner of the family or is a significant part, then a large amount of economic resources of the family can be spent on ensuring that the ailment is not neglected. Whereas for the women, it could lead to a kind of a neglect over a long period of time, and then the ailment is beyond control. The natural cause of disease may be different in women and men. For example, biologically, women's immunity is compromised during pregnancy, making them more likely to become infected during this period. So the whole idea of women's body being a certain kind of open ground for a large number of diseases like malaria, HIV, because the biological makeup of the body during the pregnancy is different, and therefore it is important to see that the women is given a safe and healthy environment over the, so that these diseases don't get impact the women. And a large number of death among pregnant women are because they have been subject to certain kind of diseases during this period. Women and men are sometimes often different levels of treatment of what appears to be the same clinical conditions. So again, the gender norms plays a very significant part, and a man and a woman may be suffering from the same clinical or medical problem, but it is in terms of the structures or the norms which would give a certain kind of medical attention to women and a different kind of attention to men. And this difference in the medical service being provided to men and women would lead to a certain kind of life-taking disease in the two population. Women and men themselves often respond different to illness. As I've already said, that it is the gender socialization where women are trained not to report, or they assume that if they fall ill or they fall sick, the family is going to suffer. So the reporting of an illness is often less among on women, and many a time the diagnosis of illness among women is at such a stage that it is beyond medical treatment. So it is very significant for women to take control over their body and their health, over the family and the community, because it is ultimately linked to the well-being of the family and the community. So society responds differently to a sick male and a female. So it could be a kind of a stigmatization if women fall sick. It is not only the medical problem or the medical illness that a woman suffer. It is coupled with the stigmatization, certain kind of treatment towards women during illness, which adds on to the medical conditions of the women. Considerable evidence exists that indicate women are hampered in the use of health services by their large number of factors that affect their access to the certain services. Lack of transport, inadequate resources, the husband refusal to grant permission. Many a time it is again whether the woman is going to access medical treatment is again gendered, in the sense that it has to be within the permission of the certain elders, certain and many a time it is a difference of opinion where one would not consider it as severe or as acute of reporting it to the medical services, and the access gets limited. Reluctance to expose themselves to healthcare provider. Again, the whole gender norms of controlling your body, your sexuality, your reproductive to certain limited private sphere, where women are shy of, they feel awkward in terms of exposing their body or taking healthcare facilities, also limits the access to medical facilities for women in India. And as a result, we see that it has some of the illness or some of the problems like AIDS has become a female affair, because there is a constant increase in the number of women who are suffering from these. And it's not necessarily that most of these are genetic or it's a biological problem. It is more because they are exposed to more vulnerable conditions. It is more because they don't have access to the right kind of health facility at the right time. It is more in terms of the opinion and attitude of men and women towards certain kind of facilities towards men and women that it has become. So women have 42% of total women in globally are now affected by the health problem. So it is very important to understand how family welfare and population policy has both the benefits and the limitations. So we need to work on the positive aspects of the family welfare and population, and look towards more holistic development of not only reproductive health of women, but mental, physical, emotional, and the most important in today's global economy is the well-being of both men and women, which is very significant.
With this note, thank you, ma'am. Thank you so very much. Today we had a very good discussion on gender and health. As we have few minutes remaining, now if we talk about gender and health in context to the workplace. Okay. So, what is the general idea?
The whole general idea is again where there are no norms related to workplace regulations, because we see that in the workplace again women's health is neglected. There are certain kind of environment which is conducive for women to work, which is not necessarily available to women workers. And as I have already said in the lecture, that this whole double burden of work, domestic work and the workforce, is in a way negatively impacting, because the stress, the burden from the house is carried to the office place, and it's a reverse transfer as well. So what leads it is actually a kind of statistics show that increase in mental depression, increase in mental illness among women, where they are not being able to cope the dual burden of the both the places. Then a large number of studies have reported that in many of these factories or in many of these workplaces, the health and hygiene conditions are not not up to the mark of the say World Health standards, and because of these, women suffer from a large number of health problems which are not. Then again, there is also the culture of where women tend to not open up. So if she is suffering from a certain kind of problem, she is not confident enough to go up and tell the management that she has a problem and take care of. So because of the fear that she might lose the job, and most of these women in say in the lower economy or in the informal sector are working because of an economic necessity. So they in a way the health is sacrificed for the economic benefit, and that is the objective of the lecture was to show that it is the norms of the society, or it is the maintenance of the society which is more significant rather than the health of the women.
With this note, thank you ma'am. Thank you so very much for giving us productive session once again. And dear friends, if you want to give your feedback for this particular lecture, then you can mail us at info.cc@nic.in. We would be meeting again very soon. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you ma'am. Thank you so very much.